In my paper, I will be looking at several countries and several cities in Central, East Central, and Eastern Europe in the period post 1945. And my focus will be not so much on the development and afterlife of single projects, but rather on the motifs behind them, and even more on general attitudes towards reconstruction. After 1945, this was a highly debated topical issue, as the devastation suffered by numerous European cities in World War II had prompted even more than after World War I fundamental questions about the most suitable way of dealing with ruined architectural monuments and urban structures. Is faithful reconstruction true to the original feasible? And even more importantly, is it desirable? Or is rebuilding in contemporary forms a proper response to the irreversibility of history? There was a wide range of answers to such questions. They had technical, economic, political, cultural, and not least ethic, moral dimensions, and they depended on various factors. For the political, cultural, and moral assessment of reconstruction ideas, the role which a country had played in the war was of key importance. I would like to illustrate this with two exemplary statements from Poland and Germany. At the site of the ruined cities, particularly Warsaw, which you see, it's a 1944 photo on the slide, Poland's general conservator Jan Zachwatowicz, he was a sort of the head of the National Monument Preservation Authority, pledged in 1946 in a heroic tone of his time, I quote him, "We will not accept the extinction of our cultural monuments. We shall reconstruct them. We shall rebuild them from their foundations in order to hand over to later generations, if not the authentic substance, so at least the precise form of these monuments, as it is alive in our memory." He justified the reconstruction of destroyed cities, city centers, with the following dramatic words. I quote him again. "Our sense of responsibility to future generations demands that we rebuild what was destroyed, that we completely rebuild it, aware of the tragedy of the conservation forgery that we are committing. Because architectural monuments are not only for gourmets, they are suggestive documents of history in the service of the masses. Even if they are deprived of their antiquarian values, they fulfill a didactic and emotional function. The issue of monuments is a key issue of the society. It is an issue of national culture. We cannot apply to this issue a one-sided abstract theory." And this was, of course, a polemic of Zachwatowicz against the anti-reconstructivist principles of modern monument preservation as it was established in the decades around 1900 by such theorists as Alois Riegel or Georg de Hio. To end the quotation of Zachwatowicz, "We have to consider the needs of the present." And this is what happened. Warsaw's old town and other destroyed historic cities in Poland have been reconstructed mainly during the late 1940s and the 1950s for the needs of the present. For Zachwatowicz and other promoters of this reconstruction policy, this was a sort of imperative, not only for the unprecedented scale of destruction, but also and even more so due to the fact that Warsaw had been deliberately and systematically ravaged by the German occupants. I quote Zachwatowicz again, Several historic buildings have been destroyed not by accident in armed struggles, but as a deliberate act of by the Nazis to eradicate Polish cultural achievements. Zachwatowicz pointed this out retrospectively in 1965. The fact that a destruction of a city or of a building had been not just an accident, as he puts it, was also used as an argument in the post-war destructions of reconstruction policy, in the post-war, discussions on reconstruction policy in Germany. Yet in the country of the perpetrators, this statement had a totally different meaning and contrary consequences. The most prominent example of this is the protest against the envisaged reconstruction of the Goethe House in Frankfurt. You see the ruin on the slide. A protest which the publicist Walter Dürks formulated in 1947. So it's quite the same time as Zachwatowicz's statement. I quote Walter Dürks: "This house was not destroyed by a burning flat iron or by a lightning stroke. It was not a destruction by accident. It was not a mistake of history one could correct. It was not a glitch of history. This extinction is justified. This extinction is correct, and therefore we have to accept it. What we now need is the strength to say farewell. Mut zum Abschied." That's the famous German wording for this slogan, for this attitude. Dürks and other opponents of the reconstruction project, which was accompanied by passionate debates that can be seen as paradigmatic for the early post-war period in Western Germany, demanded from the nation the willingness to say goodbye to the Goethe House, as well as to other destroyed monuments of symbolic and emotional value, and thereby to accept their loss as a historical consequence of the guilt the Germans had burdened themselves with under the Nazi regime. The motto of the supporters, there were also supporters of the reconstruction, was Mut zur Treue, which means having something like having the strength to be faithful, meaning remaining faithful to the German German virtues, German ideals represented by personalities like Goethe as a basis for a new beginning. In the case of the Goethe House, this latter concept, Mut zur Treue, was finally successful. You see the reconstruction on the slide. But in many other cases of destroyed historic buildings, the West Germans indeed demonstrated their strength to in saying farewell. These two statements, Zachwatowicz being strongly in favor of reconstruction as a political and cultural imperative for the nation, and Walter Dürks being strongly against reconstruction, both finally for the same reasons, reveal if not a rule, so at least a certain tendency in the attitudes of the post-war period. Reconstruction is widely demanded and rather unquestioned in countries which perceived themselves as victims of an aggression. Whereas in Germany, the defeated aggressor country, it was rather seen as a sort of illegitimate attempt to reverse the history. This is, of course, a simplification. The picture is, of course, more complicated. Thus, if you look around in German cities, you will see a lot of buildings that have been rebuilt in more or less original forms, despite all the moral arguments against reconstruction. Finally, the needs of the population, which simply wished back many lost buildings, and perhaps even more so the atmosphere of lost cityscapes, these needs were often triumphant over the considerations of intellectuals, as well as over the tabula rasa dreams of modernist architects and urban planners. Yet a self-conception as a victim of aggression has undoubtedly been and still is an important motif that fuels, that triggers the determination to reconstruct buildings. to mention just another post 1945 example, or even post 1944 example. Several historic buildings which had been destroyed by German troops were also reconstructed in the Soviet Union. Among them, the residences of the Tsars in Peterhof and Tsarskoye Selo close to St. Petersburg, or white parts of, you see here, Peterhof, or white parts of, of the old town of Novgorod, even several churches in Novgorod. You see one Novgorod example on the slide. The reconstruction work, which was the result of a decision of the central Soviet government, began already before the end of World War II. This is quite, this determination to reconstruct these buildings is quite remarkable, as the Stalinist Soviet Union didn't, as you know, at all appreciate generally Tsarist palaces, and it was probably even a sort of world champion in the demolition of churches at that time. One of the reasons for the particular treatment of the monuments in the area of St. Petersburg and Novgorod were, of course, the circumstances and authors of their destruction. A Soviet travel guide for Novgorod states, I quote, "During the Great Patriotic War of 1941 to 1945, the fascist barbarians intended to level Novgorod to the ground. The Special State Commission for the investigation of the atrocities of the fascist occupants assessed that the damage of the city was more than 1 billion ruble." End of quotation. The immediate reconstruction of the destroyed monuments was seen as an effective propagandistic means to demonstrate the Soviet Union's invincibility and its triumph over Nazi Germany. Half a century later, post-Soviet states decided to reconstruct numerous buildings which had been demolished for symbolic reasons by the Soviet Union. For example, in the late 1990s, the re-erection of St. Michael's Monastery in Kiev, which had been blown up on the orders of the Stalinist Soviet Ukrainian government in the 1930s, was meant to roll back a Soviet act of destruction which was perceived as a brutal attack against the Ukrainian church and the Ukrainian national culture. You see the building before the destruction and after the reconstruction on the slides. This perception as a brutal symbolic act was undoubtedly in line with the real intention of the destruction. However, an interpretation of a destruction as a humiliating act of a politically motivated aggression can also be used as an argument for the reconstruction when it is neither provable nor even evident or plausible. Thus, the Lithuanian historiography interprets the dismantling of the ruinous palace of the Grand Dukes in Vilnius in the years around 1800 emphatically as a conscious extinction, annihilation of a symbol of Lithuanian statehood by the Russian occupants. You see the ruins above and the reconstructed building as it can be seen today on the picture below. Consequently, the controversial reconstruction of this building, I think Andreas Filbert will explore this case further, which had completely disappeared more than two centuries ago, a project that has often been derided and debated, of course, by critics, has been justified by its promoters as a compensation, that's a quotation, as a compensation for historic injustice. Yet in this case, the insinuation of a political symbolic intention of the demolition seems to be based rather on a pattern of thinking of the 20th century and 21st century of our time than on an understanding of the time around 1800. As a matter of fact, the demolition of the ruins of the palace was, for this time around 1800, neither scandalous nor even exceptional. It was absolutely in line with the common approach to architectural monuments, which had lost their function. up until the late 19th century, it was not only in Tsarist Russia common practice to demolish venerable ruins, even quite intact buildings, which were from a present-day perspective historically very meaningful and of high artistic value. And the reasons for these demolitions were in most cases not of an iconoclastic, symbolical, but rather of a functional, economic, and not least hygienic nature. Nevertheless, the interpretation of the demolition of the Vilnius Palace as a foreign act of aggression against the own national identity has been an important rhetoric tool for the popularization of the reconstruction project. Only a minority of current reconstruction projects are of such a strong political nature. Since the 1980s, the postmodernist time, numerous projects have resulted chiefly from an increasing disappointment with modernist urban design, hand in hand with the desire to recreate historic buildings, or rather, in most cases, their mere facades, and thus to regain urban configurations, urban situations, and even more so the atmospheres destroyed by the war, as well as by the post-war rebuilding of cities. So it's the will to create, in other words, beautiful places serving as a sort of best room for the city, and not least to attract tourists. A particular commitment to architectural reconstruction is to be observed in present-day Germany. This can be seen as a symptom of overcoming the post-war trauma of the historical guilt of the country of perpetrators, which was so crucial for the debates, at least in Western Germany in the post-1945 period. Eastern Germany is a different example, but due to my limited time, I can't explore it now. The reconstruction projects are usually welcomed by the vast majority of the population. There is a whole set of different motifs for this common approval. The most general of them, as was already the case in the 1980s, is the discontent with modernist architecture, with its predominant tendency to uniformity, aesthetic banality, and hostility towards tradition. In a word, one could say it's coldness. This experience of alienation is reinforced by a growing feeling of instability resulting from the accelerating change of cityscapes and urban social life. Both stimulate the need for the historical appearance of cities, which provides a source of urban identity and stimulates a perception of continuity by neglecting the ruptures of history. In East Germany, however, there is also a specific political motif behind the wish to rebuild several monuments which were destroyed for ideological reasons by order on the GDR regime. It is again, I think, the idea of a symbolic correction of history, or as a sort of visual compensation for the injustice. And this is an argument very frequently used in the discussions by the promoters, by politicians, and by the citizens' initiatives involved in the projects. And this idea of the destruction of historical buildings as a symbol of the injustice suffered by the population is, I think, related to the victim consciousness which had been productive for so many reconstruction projects in different periods. And these are my last examples. This is the ongoing reconstruction of the Berlin Palace, and this is the reconstructed palace in Potsdam, and finally the blowing up of the tower of the garrison church in Potsdam, which is probably also going to be reconstructed. Thank you very much for the attention.